Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to the Daily Daily Caller Podcast, the Friday video edition. I am Derek Hunter. I am your host. Appreciate your time, your eyes, your ears, however you're getting this. And as you know, on Fridays, we always find a way to suck somebody out of their normal lives and into our miserable existence. And today is no different. We're honored to be joined by George Gilder, author of the new book, Life After Google, The Fall of Big Data and the Rise of the Blockchain Economy. I could go on your biography for the entire show, Mr. Gilder.
Well, I'm 78 years old, I should have piled up some...
Yeah, well, 20 books, the Discovery Institute, founding member. It goes on and on. Speechwriter for politicians and venture capitalist.
And President Reagan's most quoted living author.
I read your Wikipedia page.
Right,
I was going to get to that.
The Wikipedia has all sorts of crap by Susan Faludi on it. You don't want to read that.
So how does a guy go from your beginnings to being the most quoted economist by Ronald Reagan?
I wrote Wealth and Poverty, which... amazingly became a worldwide bestseller. It was had 6 months number one in France. You know, it was Sam's Z-Dad in China and Russia. It was just amazing worldwide phenomenon.
When you write a book that takes off around the world, and this one, you showed me the Chinese edition of this book, and obviously this is doing well in China. Internet is something the Chinese care about. When you write a book that just blows up around the world, you couldn't have expected that. What's that like?
No, it's always surprising.
Especially the
creativity first time. Always comes as a surprise to us. That's, if it didn't, we wouldn't need it. And socialism would work. Socialism is based on planning. It thinks that everything that we need to know, we already need to know, and we can plan the future. But creativity is always surprising. And the big discovery I make in Life After Google is that this principle is critical to information theory, which is the foundation of the internet and computer science. And because Claude Shannon says that all information is unexpected bits, essentially surprising bits.
Before we get to the new book, I want to talk about, because I was, in doing research for the show, I just got the book as you walked in here, so I apologize for not having a chance to read it. But doing research, I saw a speech that you gave, and you talk about one of your books, 1990s, Life, The Death of Television.
Life After Television.
You essentially predicted my Apple Watch, the iPhone, the computer, the digital age.
Let me do my riff. Back in the early 1990s, I said that the computer of the future would be as portable as your watch. It would be as personal as your wallet. It would recognize speech. It would navigate streets. It would collect your news and your mail and your paycheck. I might have been wrong about that.
Well, it costs a paycheck now.
It might not do windows, but it'll do doors, open doors to your future.
But what was it about?
Steve Jobs read that book and passed it out to his colleagues. So I think I had some small influence on the evolution.
What did you see that other people didn't? Because you've always been sort of, I mean, you're a 78-year-old guy, and you're talking about what comes next after Google. Why have you been able to see what somebody maybe 30 years old, 25 years old, that we all think of as the leaders in tech and the future innovators, why can you see what they can't?
Well, with Life After Television, I'd written Microcosm and Water. And Microcosm was about the microchip. It really expounded the history of the microchip, which I thought was the most important development in technology in the last 100 years. And essentially it showed that matter could be manipulated from inside. A matter wasn't something you used energy to push around from outside, but you could actually use the Brownian motion in matter to actually compute within the substrate itself, within the quantum physics of the microchip. And once you know that the microchip is going to double in its capacity every 18 months to 2 years on into the future, you could project the death of television, the rise of autonomous automobiles, the emergence of Garmin cell phones that follow me through my runs through the park and up mountains. And
well, I would take issue. You say you can project, meaning the universal. We didn't. You did. Now let's talk about Google and where we go from here, because we see right now Google is one of the biggest companies in the world. Google is Big Brother. Google is ubiquitous. You can't imagine
Google's
a world.
Google's brilliant.
You can't imagine a world without Google. Yeah. How can you imagine a world after Google?
Well, remember when IBM was a completely dominant force in technology. Everybody thought it was so powerful that it was going to extend its monopoly across the whole economy and had to be broken up by government antitrust lawyers. And essentially when that happened, IBM was pretty much over. Well, today, Google is going to be brought down by the successor to Moore's Law. Moore's Law is the law about microchips doubling in capacity every couple years. Bell's Law, Gordon Bell of Microsoft, says that every 10 years, the doubling process of Moore's Law creates between 100,000-fold increase in computing systems capability. And that requires a completely new computer architecture. And if you look on the internet today, it's chaos. You have chaos of usernames, passwords, pins, all this pedophagy that's supposed to be devoted to protecting you from hackers, but actually protects you from actually using your machine efficiently. And I think Silicon Valley's kind of having a nervous breakdown. It can't really solve the security problem, so it piles on more and more passwords and more busy
on the
work
verification,
for its
enter
users.
Your cell phone number.
Yeah. You got to essentially you got to strip before the cameras in order to transact across.
I've
the
never
internet.
Checked my email if that were the case, but Google is a unique product in human history in a lot of ways in that its product is us. We use them, and they sell us. They're not trying to sell us anything. Yeah. They're selling our information that we voluntarily give them in order to use their service. Yeah. Is that the model for the future? Do you see that collapsing?
Well, they used to be, I think that model doesn't work. They are aggregate and advertising. The advertise model is going to be eclipsed by the crypticosm, which is this efflorescence of innovation in cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, Ether, Ethereum, NEO in China, and thousands of new companies are emerging to create a new economy based on innovations in cryptography that originated with Satoshi Nakamoto, the anonymous creator of Bitcoin.
Well, how far away are we from that? Because we've seen there are a lot of people who are, first of all, don't know what Bitcoin is, but are hesitant to enter the Bitcoin market because it is so volatile. It's a $500 swing is not unusual in the course of a day.
Well, Bitcoin is, as Life After Google explains, has crucial flaws that mean, at least in its current form, it's not going to be the foundation for a new world economy and a new global monetary system, which is urgently needed at the moment as central banks generate more and more debt across the world economy to the point that we now have a kind of doomsday pot of $250 trillion of debt, which is really unsustainable. And it's great, providential, I think, that at this very moment, all around the world, the smartest young kids and entrepreneurs there are generating a new monetary system that tries to overcome the terrible flaws of the existing $5.1 trillion a day of currency trading. You know, this is, a lot of people don't know that that the largest industry in the world economy is currency trading. It's 73 times larger than all the trade in goods and services in the world put together. It's 25 times all global GDP, and it accomplishes nothing but enabling central banks to create money and solve problems for politicians today by stealing from the future. And that model will be overcome by the cryptocurrency movement.
Would that transition be a smooth one, do you think? Or there's going to be some growing pains in that switchover?
Well, there are always growing pains. History hasn't stopped, contrary to the Google Marxism, which thinks that its current technology is going to usurp human brains and release a cascade of ever more powerful machines that we can't understand, allowing us, however, to retire to beaches while Sergey Brin and Larry Page fly off to nearby planets with Elon Musk in a winner-take-all universe.
Well, explain a little more, because you write a lot about Google Marxism. What do you mean by Google Marxism? Is Marxism, or is Google Marxism different? What do you mean
no,
by that?
No, it's just the same. Marxism began, the essential error of Karl Marx was to say that the new technologies of his day, of the 19th century, were the steam engine, the railroad, the turbines, the dark satanic mills, all the technology, and the beginnings of electricity. All these technologies were a final human accomplishment. They solved the problem of productivity for all time. And in the future, we wouldn't worry about creating wealth anymore. We'd simply focus on redistributing wealth. And that was the essential empirical premise of Marxism. Google Marxism says that their technologies, their artificial intelligence, their machine learning, their search engines, their robotics, their algorithms, their self-driving cars, comprise a similar final moment of human accomplishment. And they even go beyond Marx. This doesn't merely obsolete human labor, it obsoletes human minds. And this is a vast exaggeration, a sort of delusional exaggeration of the significance of their very excellent artificial intelligence technology, very useful, creates jobs, doesn't destroy jobs, enhances human minds rather than displaces human minds. They just have a fundamental misunderstanding of their technology that they inflate into what Bill Buckley used to call an eschaton. That is a final thing, apocalyptic final event is somehow an effect of your technology, and this is the kind of vanity of Silicon Valley.
Let me ask you this. Because I want to get a little bit, because you write in Life After Google about the culture out in Silicon Valley. We'll get into that in a second. But listening to you talk just there, do you hold Google in contempt or do you admire Google?
Well, I admire Google. Google is this Bell's Law regime is dominated by Google. They've created 43 megahertz search engine that does 40-some thousand searches a second all day long, and each search taking thousands of steps. I mean, it's just an absolutely awesome achievement. But it's based on a system of giant warehouses conducted under a regime of cloud computing, sited near waterfalls and glaciers to dispose of the heat, linked to windmills and solar cells for cosmetic sanctimony, right. And to have a net zero carbon right. footprint. And all this is just is over. That whole model of how to do computing is going to be replaced by the new cryptocosmic model, the
blockchain. What is blockchain?
Blockchain takes all these centralized databases where you got to go to the database and have a separate username and password and mother's maiden name for every different site you visit to a distributed model where all the data is put in an immutable database and distributed through all the nodes on the network.
So everything's everywhere?
Everything's everywhere. Since everything's everywhere, you can't steal it in one place. You have to control more than 51% of
it. Will you not be able to monetize it then under that model if you can't have access to it?
The individuals who participate in the blockchain, their identity, they'll have a single identity, a single private key, a single access to the internet that all the web pages in the internet will have to recognize. In other words, they will control their own identity and their content rather than depending on some remote a data center to control their identity and content, so, and then petition, and with the stripping before the camera process of security on the internet.
So the television, 1990, you were about 18 to 20 years ahead of the curve. Now, with life after Google, how much life would you say Google has?
IBM still a big company.
Well, I understand that, Google, but I mean, when do we get to this new?
Well, it's happening. It's happening right now. I mean, the great problem of the U.S. economy is the doldrums of entrepreneurship. We talk about a stock market boom, but the stock market is only half the size in the number of public companies as it was 20 years ago. The number of initial public offerings with crucial entrepreneurial process going public has dropped 90%. There's a real crisis of the IPO inflicted largely by the administrative state.
Would you say that's a lack of innovation, or is that giant companies like Facebook and Google seeing something coming up and saying, we're going to assimilate that rather than let that become its own thing?
Neither. It's a result of the administrative state strangling the whole process of investment. It started with Sarbanes-Oxley. It's been piling up ever since. The rule of the Securities and Exchange Commission is it's illegal to invest in anything you know about. But any investment that's not based on something you really know intimately is useless. So much of the market is now rotates among 500 favored firms, and the whole effervescence of entrepreneurial creativity represented by NASDAQ and the constant proliferation of new companies has been halted in the United States. It continues in China, by the way. The communists are better at this today than we are.
Communists are better at capitalism than we are. Why did that come about? So I believe I remember when I worked in the United States Senate about a decade ago, there was this new rule that you had to have a net worth of over $1 million or something like that in order to sort of kind of qualify as an angel investor, to be even able to, if your friend was starting a company, and he said, okay, if I give you 10 grand, can you give me like 5% of your company? It was illegal unless you have $1 million in assets, which is just basically, you stay down where you, government saying, you stay down there, leave the money to us.
It's an absolute scandal the way investment is regulated. I mean, essentially what it means is the only people who really make money are insider trading. Well, that's the result of all the
people already have money.
And that's because returns have bifurcated between great conglomerates that are essentially just allocating capital. Google never buys a company without complete intimate knowledge of all the inside details. Kleiner Perkins venture capitalists never invest in a company without knowing the intimate details of insider knowledge of the entire nooks and crannies of the company. Warren Buffett never makes an investment without intimate inside knowledge. It's only the poor saps in the middle.
The 401ks trying to get by,
who are banned from knowing anything about the companies they invest in. And it's an outrage. It's to restrict investment to people with $1 million. I mean,
how are you ever supposed to get there? That's the whole thing.
However, this problem is already being solved right now by a new cryptographic platform called Ethereum, which over the last 12 months has raised some $20 billion for several thousand new startups and in what's called initial coin offerings, ICOs. Now, we're waiting for the SEC to do for ICOs what they've already done to IPOs, practically extinguish the IPO market. Now they're moving to extinguish the ICO market. But actually, there's quite a lot of controversy at the SEC, and there's quite a lot of support at the SEC for not stifling this new form of entrepreneurial finance that's the most creative part of the U.S. economy.
So you say the biggest hurdle that this new economy faces is the old economy saying you can't do that, and the powers that created the old economy preventing them.
Yeah, it's always, I wrote
it's
about that, in wealth and poverty. That's the perpetual struggle in economics, is between the old established companies and the new companies rising up to challenge and displace them.
That's the thing. People think that big businesses are conservative, they're Republican, they want a free market economy. They don't. They love weaponizing the government against new entrants and their opponents constantly. They lobby to get regulations that stop new businesses from coming into existence. How can the new future that you're talking about, that's trying to get out of its egg right now, come into existence when you've got this massive force behind it?
It's true. However, the cryptochasm is amazingly robust, and it's erupting all around the world. It'll move from one country to another. China moves against ICOs, and all the leading ICO companies in China metastasize to Singapore, which welcomes them, or the Cayman Islands, or wherever. Zug, Switzerland, which is a big center. You know, it's pretty irrepressible, I think, this cryptocosm. And it's true that, the market's down now, but it's what I call a diving board model of entrepreneurial activity. The entrepreneur begins by preening on the diving board and posturing and claiming the great things he's going to achieve. And then after he raises his money, he dives, and you don't see him for a long time. And all the people sitting in edge of the pool say he's never going to come up. And in fact, 46% of all the ICOs have already pretty much gone bust. But then 10 years later, you look and there's a Google and there's an Amazon and there's a Facebook and there's a whole array of new companies emerging. And I think that's what we're going to see with the cryptocosm. It's the new generation.
The cream rises to the top, and you can't stop it. You might be able to delay it, but you can't stop it. Now, as we wrap it up here, life after Google, talk a little bit about the culture out in Silicon Valley, because we live here in a bubble in Washington, D.C., and people can't really understand what life is like in the rest of the world. And the rest of the world can't imagine. You go to a happy hour and the first thing people ask you is, where do you work? Who do you work for? What do you? That's all they care about. And if it's not impressive enough, they walk away. It's its own world unto itself. What is the world of Silicon Valley like?
Well, it's Silicon Valley is the most fertile area in the global economy. Maybe even still, it's got a lot of competition from Shenzhen and places in China. But Silicon Valley and Israel is sort of the real Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley feeds on a steady stream of innovations that originate in Israel. Like the Ethereum technology really was inspired by a trip by Valeric Buterin to Israel, where he... So I think that, this is an efflorescence of human creativity, and it's exciting, and it's going to transform our economy and probably global monetary systems as well, solving many of the problems that from IPO dearth to entrepreneurial doldrums to monetary chaos to
with all the problems that it solves, does it create new ones?
I suppose, but the internet created new problems. Mm-hmm. But as long as the entrepreneurial process remains fertile and creative, the problems get solved as they're... And the real rule in enterprise is don't solve problems. When you solve problems, you feed your failures, you starve your strengths, and you achieve costly mediocrity. That's what government specializes in doing, solving problems. Pursue opportunities is the rule of enterprise. And that's what the cryptocosm creating the life after Google is doing today all around the world.
The human spirit always finds a way. The book, Life After Google, The Fall of Big Data and the Rise of the Blockchain Economy. Mr. Gilder, I would ask you if you could sign both of these books.
I have certainly will.
A pen right there, I believe. Even work.
Should I sign it to you?
No, if you could sign both of them, you can win one if you email Derek, D-E-R-E-K, at dailycaller.com. And the other one will go into my personal collection.
Maybe I'm this. Host. That's this, what I, maybe I should sign with a better pen.
If you had a pen, we'll give away that one. Thanks for watching.
Does anyone got a pen?
We'll get you that off air. Thank you for coming in. I appreciate it. It's a fascinating conversation.
Thank you.
Pick up the book. It's out now. It's been out for a while. It's selling gangbusters. Get one now before it rolls over you.